Namaskar. We are continuing our series on the farmers' issues in India. If you can recall, in one of our last videos, we mentioned the word industrial agriculture. And we said that that was something very important for us to understand, especially in view of the fact that the farm bills introduced recently in India seem to suggest that we ought to move in that direction. The direction of industrial agriculture. Before we get into what it is, let us look also at another interesting fact as to who all are happy with our farm bills. In India, of course, there are two sections. The section supporting the government says they are for these farm bills, and the other section, largely the farmers protesting outside Delhi, is of course objecting tooth and nail to this policy change. You may be surprised that outside of this country too, there is a lot of support for these bills. People have been talking about the opposition to these bills from pop star singers, but actually there are more important players and more important news that we should be looking at. Who are supporting these farm bills in India? One, the US government. Two, the European Union and many countries in Europe. Three, politicians across political parties in the West. Four, probably even the Japanese government, if I'm not mistaken. And five, the World Bank and also the IMF, whose president, who is of Indian origin, recently gave a statement that she supports these farm bills and hopes that it will improve the lot of the Indian farmers. So there it is. It's something you may be surprised at, considering that they are in their own economies, in their own nations, and why is it that they are all supporting the farm bills here? And that brings us to the relationship of the support for these farms, especially from the likes of World Bank and IMF, and the subject we are going to discuss today, industrial agriculture. The reason for this is that the World Bank and the IMF, at the prodding of many US corporations and other powerful entities which control the way the world economy is conducted, they, for a very, very long time, for more than two decades now, have been pressurizing the Indian government to move towards industrial agriculture. They have been asking us to do this movement by demanding three changes, three fundamental changes. One, they have asked us to remove subsidies that we give to our farmers. Two, they have asked us to allow free trade, which means easing of import restrictions so that they can send their agricultural commodities here, and also easing of export restrictions so that our commodities too can flow out to wherever it wants to go. And three, they have demanded that we allow corporations to enter the field of agriculture. So what they have been working at for more than 25 years, through these bills, are they beginning to succeed? All the support that we are getting from the powerful economic quarters of the world, the global powerful who are supporting these farm bills, seems to suggest that they may be happy. Some of them may be very happy about what these three bills are doing. Because one, our first bill, without saying in so many words, hints that it wants to reduce the subsidy and the minimum support price paid to our farmers. The second bill very clearly eases exports, and the government administrative action following these bills in November-December 2020, reducing the import bills on various agricultural commodities, all that seems to indicate it. For instance, customs duty on maize was reduced from 50 to 15%. The import duty on some lentils, masoor dal maybe, was reduced by 20%. and the import duty on palm oil was reduced from 37.5% to 27.5%. So these two are all in tune with the demands being made by this World Bank IMF lobby. And the third demand of theirs, the toughest for us to implement for so many years, has been done now with the corporate bill, the third bill, which now says that, you know, contractual agreements by corporations with farmers and the direct entry of corporations into farm production, farm processing, farm distribution, all that is eased and it's now possible. If any of you have not seen what the contents of our farm bills are and would like to do so, I'll put a link of that in the text description below. So this is the crux to move Indian agriculture from its path of small farmer-owned, small farmer-run livelihoods to big entities entering the field of agriculture. This is industrial agriculture or corporate agriculture. And to understand that, I feel it's very interesting and useful to study the experience of the USA, which primarily is the experiment which is fueling this change all over the world. Let us have a look at that. Till recently, about 80-85 years ago, 25% of American families were living on their farms. More than 75 lakh families were living in farms, were doing useful agricultural productive work, and they were running their livelihoods and contributing to the American economy. The government too supported them quite well. You know, they had set a minimum floor price for the produce that that came out of these small farms. And the government also helped in set up a lot of warehouses all over the country for the collection and storage of the grains and other items produced by these 70 lakh farming families. But in the 1970s and 80s, the US government started to roll back this policy. It changed track. It brought in new policy aimed at encouraging the entry of big corporations in the field of agriculture. It not only encouraged the big corporations to enter, it discouraged the small farmer from continuing to do farming. There is a very famous, or rather infamous, quote attributed to the then agriculture secretary in the Nixon administration, who said, "Get big or get out." And that really happened. More than 50 lakh American families were forced out of the agricultural landscape over the next 40 to 50 years. And so today, only 2% of American families live on farms. More than 70% of American agriculture is controlled by a handful of corporations. This is what is termed as industrial agriculture or corporate agriculture, which now the US is pushing for us and for other countries in Asia and Africa to follow. Strangely, even as 50 lakh small farming families disappeared from the agriculture landscape in America, the food productivity kept increasing. And that is because what the big corporations brought with it is big investment and big technology. And they also were able to play the margins. You know, having control of a bigger and bigger market share enabled them to work on thin margins, the kind of margins which would destroy any small farmer. Let us have a look at what the effect or the benefits of this has been to the United States. On the question of hunger, are people not going hungry anymore in the US? That is not true, of course. More productivity does not mean food for everyone. More productivity means more food for those who can afford it. And if you have chased out 50 lakh small farming families out of the agriculture sector, driven them out in a state of poverty, in a state of debt, you know, to work as labor or to work or to search for any other work in as migrant labor anywhere else, surely without a capacity to buy food, they are going to go hungry. Which is why, as recently as 2017, a report from the US says that 16 million Americans reported that they have experienced food insecurity is the technical word for saying I went hungry for some time in this past year. On the state of health, what is the state of health in the US? Unfortunately, it's not very good. The United States of America is one of the sickest nations in the world in terms of the diseases that its people have. It is also among the sickest nation in the world in terms of the per capita prescription drug use among its population. So higher food productivity, the cornering of food activity by corporations with their efficient methods has not resulted in better health for its society. What about pollution? What about the environment? Unfortunately, the practices followed by the big agriculture involves much higher use of chemicals, much higher use of chemical pesticides. It uses other procedures and practices in farming which lead to soil depletion, to soil erosion, which lead to reduction of water and lowering of the water table. It leads to pollution of rivers and many other such side effects, disastrous side effects. So the health of the environment too has not benefited because of big agriculture. What about the social sector? Surely, you know, more food being produced, more profits being made by these companies, somewhere has society, you know, has is it better? Is it happier? Well, unfortunately, that is also not true. According to a very recent statistics of 2017-18, the farm sector suicide rate in America has grown faster over the last 17 to 18 years than the homicide rate in America. Some of you may know that the homicide rate in America is among the highest in the world. And the suicide rate apparently in the rural sector is higher even than the homicide rate. So it's not a very, very clear black and white thing that, you know, just because more food is being produced, maybe more efficiently in terms of how efficiency is defined, but that does need not necessarily mean a better health for every citizen of the country. It may not mean better equitable distribution of food for everyone in the country. It may not mean a better health for its environment. And it certainly does not mean a better and more harmonious social society. Let us have a look at one of the basic premise of this movement towards industrial agriculture. Why do they want subsidy removed for the farmer? Somewhere is there a benefit? I mean, somewhere has the US agriculture benefited from removal of subsidies? Or has it actually removed subsidies? That is the first question to answer. And the surprising answer is that no. The United States has not removed subsidies for its farmers. Its farmers have changed. The profile of its farmer has changed from small farmer to big farmer. From 70 lakh small farmers to just, you know, say 70 big corporations controlling 75% of the agriculture. But they, the rich corporations, are taking as much, if not more, subsidy than the small farmers used to take. That's quite amazing, isn't it? They did not remove subsidy in their system, but they want us to remove subsidy to our genuinely poor farmer in our system. Let me give you some statistics. According to the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, the USA spends nearly $62,000 per farmer. $62,000 per farmer as its subsidy. In the European Union, which is an average of many of the countries in Europe, they are spending $8,580 per person, per farmer in the European Union. That is the amount of subsidy from the government statistics. How much did India give last year? It gave $210 per farmer. So who gets the subsidy in the United States of America? Last year alone, in 2020, the Trump administration gave $46 billion as agriculture subsidy to its farming community. Who got that subsidy? The top 1%, that is, the rich, very rich, large, very large corporations who have entered agriculture, they got the top 1% got 26% of the subsidy. An interesting study in the US reveals that in the last 25 years, out of the $230 billion of subsidy that has been given in the field of agriculture, the top 10% of the richest farmers, which are represented by corporations, they cornered, I think, up to 78% of the subsidy, while 62% of the small farmers in America did not get any subsidy payments at all. This is quite shocking, isn't it? So while on the one hand, the success story of industrial agriculture keeps pointing towards more efficiency, more productivity per labor used, more productivity per land acreage used, and more productivity period. But in all the other parameters, you know, we should reflect a good society, a civilized society, an equitable society. It is failing in all those fronts. Let me give you one last additional statistics. Among the Forbes 400 list of wealthiest people in America, do you know that it includes 50 billionaires who call themselves farmers? 50 billionaires who are actually heads of corporations which control massive amounts of the agriculture production and trade in the US. That is, to sum it all, is the result of the American experiment for the last 75 years of industrial agriculture, or we can call it corporate agriculture. Now, when we say that the American government and the American corporations and the European Union and the IMF and the World Bank, they are all pushing us and prodding us towards industrial agriculture. When we say that, how do they do it? The means to get that done is the WTO, where trade agreements between various nations are signed, and many agreements are even coerced upon the poorer countries who have no option but to sign. And the moment they sign, they are forced, according to that contract, to open up, various policies. They open up and introduce new policies in their governments. In this case, what the WTO has done is to have a thing called Agreement on Agriculture, AOA. The Agreement on Agriculture is something they have been working on for many decades now. And interestingly, the Agreement on Agriculture is completely controlled, that initiative, and it is being run by, guess who? The World Economic Forum. Now, what is the World Economic Forum? It's a body of billionaires, to put it simply. It is a rich boys club in the world, and the rich boys club which wants its domination in the world. And the World Economic Forum is actually the organization which is holding the initiative, which is driving the initiative of the Agreement of Agriculture, putting pressure on various governments over a period of time. It has succeeded to a large extent in Africa, and now its big target in Asia is India. And they want us to do all these things that these three new laws are attempting to do, and they want us to completely copy the American system of industrial agriculture. This is disturbing to us, but it's also obvious why they are doing it, isn't it? I mean, why should the billionaires be interested in farmers' movements? But in the US, it is the billionaires who control the agriculture, and it is they who receive the maximum amount of subsidies, which are given, which are in billions and billions of dollars. And this control of food is something that they have been eyeing for a long time. Now, the World Economic Forum launched this initiative, to bring about this industrial agriculture change in the world through an initiative called the New Vision for Agriculture, NVA. And the New Vision for Agriculture had as its target countries in Africa and Asia. And in Asia, a very, very big target is, of course, India. And that target, they also formed a few years ago an NVA India Business Council, and it had for its members various multinational corporations whose list, if I read out to you, will give you an indication of what this initiative is and in which direction they want the new agriculture vision to go. Now the members include Monsanto, the seed maker, the genetic modified seed maker, and the company which purchased Monsanto recently, Bayer of Germany, two known names, you know, in the field of agriculture malpractice. It has Cargill India, a huge US grain aggregator. Then they have Dow AgroSciences, again a GMO seed and pesticide producer. And then they have DuPont, another chemical agriculture firm. Then they have a cartel giant, you know, Louis Dreyfus. And they also have Pepsi and Nestle. You will wonder what their connection is, but they do have a connection, and their links with the agriculture produce companies are enormous because they both support and promote corporate contract farming. And they also have a reinsurer. This is another pet theme of the corporate players. Along with the corporate players who have entered production in agriculture, there are other corporate players who have entered insurance of agriculture. That's another game that they are playing. And recently, the Indian government seems to be, loving this theme of insurance for the small Indian farmer, not understanding that our situation is totally different from theirs. And it has another Indian member in this group. Maybe some of you have not heard of him, maybe some have. His name is Gautam Adani. Now, the World Economic Forum itself, which sits in Davos in Switzerland, it has Mukesh Ambani also, by the way, as its member. So it appears that these companies, you know, whether they are from Bayer of Germany or Nestle of, you know, Switzerland, or it could be some companies from India, it appears that when it comes to the billionaire boys club, they don't care about citizenship and identity and nations and, you know, society. You know, they have they work according to a different plan. And it seems that they are all in agreement with this. The billionaires seem to be of one mind that industrial agriculture is needed in India. If industrial agriculture succeeds in India, who do you think will corner the vast amounts of subsidy that the Indian government will then divert from the small farmer to the big corporations running agriculture? And that is industrial agriculture or corporate agriculture, or what in America they are now calling as the big ag. Do we need the big ag or corporate agriculture in India? Does it suit our requirements? That is a very important question for us, isn't it? For us, as in us, and for our government. They have to get a clarity on this and communicate that clarity to all of us so that we know in which direction we are headed. Thank you for watching these videos. I will put my email in the text description below. If any of you would like to ask some questions or make some suggestions, you're welcome to do so.